your host, Quentin Cooper.
Good evening, thank you very much. It's lovely to be called the Anagram King, which is probably an anagram of something which I'll think of later. So welcome one and all to everybody here, and also everybody watching worldwide via the internet, to the international final of Famelab, something that started right here. Well, actually, not right here, it was, I think, the tent just over there, but has now spread to all over the world. It is now the biggest science communication competition on the planet. In fact, not just, I'll go further. Feel free to be excitable, that's what an audience is about. I'll go further, in fact, it is the biggest in the known universe. Although that last bit is not so much down to the success of Famelab as to the failure of the search for extraterrestrial intelligence. Countless thousands have now entered in dozens of countries. We've had over 100 different national winners, but only 6 have gone on to become Famelab international champions. Tonight, there will be a 7th. Now, if that makes it sound like you're in for an evening of intensely serious scientific competition, do not worry. This is Famelab, it is not Fame of Thrones. There's a lot squeezed into those heads, but there will be no actual head squeezing going on. That's a bit of a spoiler for those who've not kept up with the latest episodes. And I do give a bonus point to the competitor from last night who managed to get the phrase winter is coming into their presentation. Now, I don't know how many of you were here at last year's final? And you came back! How nice, great. But one of the ones who was here last year hasn't come back for other reasons was the Nobel Prize-winning co-discoverer of the structure of DNA, James Watson. He was there in the audience, I didn't even know he was in the audience. Now, if anybody's ever run into James, he's not one to splash compliments around, but he told us it was the best night out he's had in years. I should stress that he was 85 at the time, he's not up and out coming, but nevertheless, it's not bad. It's tough to beat as a recommendation, but if we do have any Nobel laureates in the audience tonight and you enjoy yourselves, please do, you know, come up to us afterwards. For those who've not yet had the call from the Swedish Academy, I don't want you to feel disenfranchised. So if you're an Oscar winner or a Pulitzer winner and you enjoy tonight, please do get in contact. If it's a BAFTA, or a Turner, or a Sony. Nah, don't bother, we're sorted. So for those who've not previously entered the Fame Labyrinth, the rules are simple. Well, actually, they're quite complicated, but the key bits are relatively simple. Each finalist has 3 minutes, plus another 2 minutes for judges' questions to clearly and charismatically convey something of the magnificence and significance of science. The resonance and relevance, the wow and how, the beauty and the booty, the magnitude with attitude. You get the idea. Now this year, a record-breaking 23 national winners representing 25 countries, it's complicated, have come to Cheltenham to battle it out for the honour, and it is mostly honour, the surprises aren't that big, of being declared Famelab International Champion 2014. 25 countries. Here's a fact for you. Took the World Cup 50 years to get up to 24 finalists. We are at 25 and we've only been going for 7 years. That's impressive. Plus you don't have to watch them now. Now, they're all national winners. They're all Famelabulous, but of those 23 people, only 10 representing 13 countries, it's still complicated, have made it through the 2 semi-finals tonight, and only one of them will be crowned Famelab International Champion 2014. Who that will be? It's down to our judges. They've got to make the momentous, portentous decision as to who the winner and the 2 joint runners-up will be. So let's get them up here. Shockingly, it's now over 25 years since our chair first made it onto the cover of best-selling UK magazine, The Radio Times. Since then, her multiple skills as anatomist, osteoarchaeologist, anthropologist, paleopathologist, and being great in front of a cameraist have made her one of the best-known faces of British science. And she's also one of the team of presenters on BBC Radio 4's much-loved, most-listened-to science programme in the UK, Material World's recent replacement, Inside Science. Applause, please, for Professor Alice Roberts. Like
Like Alice, the second member of our triumvirate is a TV and radio regular, and surely it can only be a matter of time before he has Alice as a guest on the Life Scientific. Like her, he's also a professor of public engagement in science, but unlike her, he's bald and a theoretical physicist. Please smash your hadrons together for Professor Jim Al-Khalili. I saw a tweet from somebody saying, the strangest sight I've seen at the Cheltenham Science Festival, Jim Al-Khalili in a plain shirt. He knew he couldn't compete. Now, completing our trio, we have someone who's Greek but now lives in the UK and has the French equivalent of a knighthood for his work in science communication. He's also a novelist, playwright, artificial intelligence expert, and according to his Twitter account, expert cook of mushroom spaghetti sauce. Please welcome Pasta Master Dr. George Zarkadakis. With the exception of you three judges and me, and the act we're going to see in the interval, everybody we're going to see on stage tonight has earned their right to be here. They're winners and they've won through the semi-finals as well. So how are you going to pick amongst all those winners an uber winner?
It is going to be extraordinarily difficult. I think all of us know that. So these people have already won in order to get to the Famelab finals. I mean, that in itself is a massive, massive achievement. So finding a winner tonight is going to be very difficult indeed. But we are looking for that special something which shines through. We are looking for the ability to engage everybody in the room with science. And we also need that science to be crystal clear and to be accurate as well. So that's what we've got our eye on tonight.
So a bit of content, a bit of clarity, a bit of charisma. Absolutely. Which is great. A lot more unmessaged than the judges last night who, when asked the same question, declared props, musical numbers and looks. That's what you get for having Mark Lithgow on the panel. Jim, new this year, everybody's going to be doing a presentation different to what they did in the semi-finals. Do you think that's going to help sort out the people who've got strength in depth?
I think so. I mean, it's hard enough for most of these contestants because English isn't their first language. So to get a polished performance, to explain a scientific concept is hard enough. To then have to do something completely different for this final, I think is going to be a bit of a challenge, but it'll, I think, help discriminate those who are, not that anyone among the 10 are in this category, but you know, you can polish your performance, you can deliver something that's very well honed. Having something different, I think, will bring out those who are really good at communicating science itself.
Fine. Jim did that answer by way of contrast there. Now, John.
Yes, sir.
And George, finally, you get 2 minutes. You get 2 minutes to grill each of them. What will you be looking for that's going to make the difference? Because I imagine when it's all this close, those 2 minutes of questions could make a big difference.
I think what's important to understand is that these people are actual scientists. They're not actors. They really know what they're talking about. They're part of science and scientific culture. So what we will be asking them is to perhaps clarify one point, perhaps touch on another point that they didn't explain, and really dig a little bit deeper into the science of the presentation.
Okay, it is an impossible, invidious task, and we are very grateful to our three judges for volunteering to do it. So one more time, can we have some applause for Jim? I'm going to be influenced by your applause and cheers, so make some noise, although not too much at appropriate times. This is Cheltenham, after all. Now, as well as a winner and two joint runners-up that are decided by the judges, there will also be a Famelab Alumni Award, where we kind of go all Eurovision and give each of the participating countries a single vote, and that will decide, and they are allowed to vote for their own finalists as well, so that will be quite interesting, so surprise for that. And there is a prize, the audience prize. And if you can't work out who votes on that one, then you do not deserve to take part in it. Now, I'll explain exactly what you need to do later at roughly the time you need to do it. But just before we wheel out our first finalist, I've got a message here for all the competing Famelabbers. And it's from last year's international winner and Irish champion, Fergus McAuliffe. I won't do his accent. Hi, everyone. Well done on getting this far. I have three pieces of advice to help you in the finals. Relax, relax, relax. If you remember these, you'll give a fantastic talk. Famelab has been great for me this past year, and it'll be great for all of you too. Prepare to get very busy when you arrive home. Good luck. So thank you, Fergus. Good luck from me too. Good luck, I suspect, from our judges, if I could, you know, guess that they're saying that as well. Just remember, 90% of you are destined not to win, if that helps. Right, enough yappage. Stand by for clappage. To decide an order, we drew straws, rolled dice, cast rooms, and picked names out of a previously rabbit-infested hat. Thank you, Adam Malone. And the first name chosen was that of our Italian champion, Marco Ferrigo. Marco loves maths, he likes laughs, he draws graphs, and generally does anything he can to make mathematical concepts fun for everyone via games and workshops and exhibitions. All this while still being a student at the University of Pisa, working on analytical models for the development of cancerous cells. The tower at Pisa is famously a little bit off-center. I think you'll find the same might apply too to our Italian Famelab champion, Marco Ferrigo.
I'm a music teacher, and today is Tuesday, the day of the fourth grade, my favorite one. I'm in the classroom now, and I'm saying, Jacob, today you will choose a song, and we'll all try to play it together. No, teacher, the exams are just in 2 weeks. We have to be able to distinguish a D sharp from C flat. But, well, let's try at least to listen to some great composer to get inspired, okay? No, teacher, listening. Listening to real music is really advanced. We are able to do that just at university. And now I start to feel that something is wrong. I start to sweat and I would like to shout, and then I wake up again as a mathematics teacher in 2014. Math and science that we teach our students is not completely aimed at forming new scientists. Its first aim is to form citizens and people or an inhabitant of this world. And we tried tonight to describe an alternative model to the this is maths usage in your life. I will try to describe the model of you tell me what you like doing in your life, and I'll tell you the math in it and how it can help it. And I would like to start with the lady in the first row to ask what she likes, but actually she's playing with her phone, so I'll just say that she was checking her Facebook. Then I would ask her, do you know how does Facebook suggest us friends that are actually real friends to us in our lives? Well, they use the structure of a graph. A graph is a very simple mathematical structure, and they see me and her and every Facebook user as dots, points, and friendships between us as lines. And using simple algorithms, they are able, which are very similar to those used by train companies, to get the fastest way from station A to station B. But changing subject, the man in the second row was asking, well, I like to study insects, what do you have for me? Well, have you ever wondered why do bees construct cells of hexagonal form? Well, this is an extremely interesting journey through the mathematics. And this requires you to understand why there are just three different kinds of tilings, one with triangles, squares, and hexagons, and why bees, those wonderful mathematical insects, choose the hexagons, which is the most similar to a circle, the shapes that recreates the greatest area given a fixed perimeter. The mathematics that we teach at school should not be requiring you to be interested in our problems, but we should give you the mathematics that is really suitable for your lives. And asking you to be interested in mathematical problems is like stealing from you. Is like stealing from you fantasy and clarity and the possibility to have faith in science. So what I would like you to do is to ask for those things back.
Maybe a different kind of science.
The point is that many mathematicians really study with a scientific method what kind of mathematics should be taught in schools. And this can be done by experiments via statistical records, and this is something that I've done during my studies, and this is something that I really love. I know it's a bit different from the standard Famelab presentation, but this is who I am.
I'd like to ask you, where in our lives do you think maths is most relevant? Where could you bring out the relevance most?
Well, I think that the most surprising aspect of it is that we can find really, really simple mathematics in everything we do every day. From when we start and wash our teeth and decide, wash our tools and have a shower and decide which we'll do first, if wash our hair, the ones who have it. Or wash our body. And that is a mathematical decision. There are so pretty much everywhere, really, in the simplest things we do.
It was interesting that you said that some people studying actually what kind of maths should be taught at school. So I'd like to ask you this question, if you know. Are there different types of people that are attracted, let's say, towards algebra, and different types of brains that are attracted towards geometry? Is there a different
situation? The whole point of my studies, of my talk, is that it's not a matter of algebra or geometry. It's a matter of finding the kind of mathematics that is suitable to what you are interested in. It might be a combination of algebra and geometry.
Post-match analysis, but Marco Farigo, anagram, error of language.
What you heard there was, I think, was the first and I hope last post-Famelab bit to the audience in addition to the questions. And they do have 3 minutes, you have to keep it tight. What you do in those 3 minutes is entirely up to you, so we have no problem with that.
Second up is our French Famelab winner, David Davila. A neuroscience student, when asked after his victory why he'd entered Famelab, David said, "Because it's so much fun to get on stage and tell people why the brain is cool. It never stops being awesome." As you'll gather from this, David is not French. He's from California, but he's now studying neuroscience in Paris, and when not researching the brain or chatting about it with friends, he's actually doing stuff about it online as the co-host of the Brain Drain podcast. His immediate reaction after winning the French final was, "Yell, I'm going to move on to Cheltenham, baby." He has, and now he's moved on to the international final. So get your brains, especially your visual cortices, up to speed for the Californian French Famelab fusion of David Davila.
Hi! I'm David, and I don't know how many of you saw my talk last night, but I publicly confess to being both a neuroscientist and a huge nerd. But the thing about being a nerd is that it means that you just get irrationally excited about very specific things. So yeah, I start to freak out when I hear about a seemingly normal middle-aged man whose response to a question is, "Tono, tono, 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 tono," right? It's exciting! But as silly as he sounds, the Tono Tono guy is A, real, and he's on YouTube, and you should look him up because it's crazy. But two, it's actually a really interesting case study in how language is represented in the brain. But case studies like him don't come along very often. And because language is actually really difficult to produce, from the specific movements of our tongues to the very tiny movements of our Adam's apples to make vocal emotion happen, the question becomes, how do we study language separately from the actual act of speaking? Well, when we think of language, we usually think of spoken language, like English or French or Chinese. But actually, studies in sign language actually give us really fascinating evidence on how language is represented in the brain because it's a non-spoken language. Oppositely, Bongo has all these specific mouth movements and vocal emotion, but still lacks language. Tono Tono guy actually has damage to what's called Broca's area. It's a well-studied part of the brain that's known to be involved in speech production. And when people have damage to this part of the brain, they seem like they know what they want to say, but they just can't get it out. It's actually really bad for Famelab speakers. But the really fascinating thing about Broca's area is that even though we already know that it's involved in speech production, a recent study found that just as speakers activate it when they speak, sign language speakers activate their Broca's area when they want to make signs. That is to say, as far as your brain is concerned, sign language is just the same as any other spoken language. It just requires a different set of muscles to express it. Because of this, therapists who specialize in autism have actually started to teach autistic children sign language as part of language therapy. And they find that in this way, they can avoid all the complex features of language while still teaching language. They see that children who are taught sign language actually learn English faster than those who are only taught English. With all this in mind, I have to wonder, why do we call it sign language? It helps us communicate like every other language, and the brain treats it the same as every other language. Maybe it's time to shift our mindset on sign language by simply calling it.
To deliver the talk in spoken language and sign language simultaneously is a great skill. Can I ask you something about the science itself? You seem to suggest that whatever language we speak, it's the same parts of the brain that are being activated. Is that right?
Yes, as far as Broca's area particularly, you see consistent activation across different languages.
And so where does the difficulty of, you know, once you've learnt a particular language, learning a foreign language later in life, given that presumably it's the same concept, same part of the brain, is it just to do with practicing sounds that we find difficult to?
Okay, so no, actually. In fact, you would imagine that practicing sounds would definitely be something related to the production of speech. But while Broca's area is really just about taking the language, the lexicon, the system of grammar that you know, and producing speech with it, there are completely different areas of the brain that are involved as well with the dictionary of words that you know in your brain and the system of syntax. Some of it is found in Broca's area, but there's a lot more plasticity that you need to build in order to build a second language, as you might know.
Thank you.
I just wanted to ask you about another area of the brain. So what can you tell us about Wernicke's area?
Oh, okay. One, I'm really glad you asked that. Okay, so Wernicke's area is the second part of the brain that has been widely found to be known associated with language. Maybe you knew that, and maybe that's why you brought it up. But in regards to sign language in particular, it's been seen that Wernicke's area has been implied with the understanding of language to some extent. But with sign language speakers in particular, even though usually it's related to the auditory cortex, there are connections between those two places. In fact, Wernicke's area, for those who speak sign, has more connections and more co-activation with the occipital lobe, the part that is related to visual input. And so you see, in this way, their input for language is not the ears, but the eyes.
Brilliant. We're all out of bits of brain for that. David Biller, French Famelab champion. So two people, already two firsts. That's the first Famelab presentation I've partly seen in sign language. The only sign language I can do is that, which is witch tree. It's not tremendously useful. Now, continuing in the same have brain will travel vein, we come to our finalist representing Switzerland. Now, I say representing because their 2012 champion wasn't from Switzerland, nor was their 2013 winner, and they're clearly on a bit of a Swiss roll because their 2014 champ is the quite conspicuously Scottish Jennifer Fowley. Thank you for the groans. Now, having originally got a physics degree from St. Andrews, she's now studying in Geneva, which is where she entered Famelab and won. Jennifer's used to cramming a lot into not much space. Her PhD is in condensed matter physics. But how good is she at cramming a lot into not much time? We should have a clear idea after 180 Swiss time seconds with Jennifer Fowley.
Charlie. He's a newborn cheetah, and he was born with this beautiful coat. When he gets older, these spots will help him to stalk his prey without being seen. They are an evolutionary advantage. So we know why he has spots, but how? How do the colors know where to arrange themselves? The reason is not biological, it's mathematical. And it was a mathematician who first actually studied this, the father of computer science, Alan Turing. Since studying pattern formation directly is actually very difficult, Turing suggested a theory. He said, let's assume that there are two chemicals, one that makes skin light and one that makes skin dark. These two chemicals influence each other. They are in competition and they diffuse over the skin at different rates. This in mathematics is expressed as, I forget the name of this equation, as a nonlinear partial parabolic differential equation, otherwise known as a very tricky equation. And Turing was a genius. So he took this one equation of two interacting chemicals and realized that it can produce all the patterns known in nature. In fact, the pattern type depends only upon the surface area of the skin. So if you have a very small area of skin, there is no pattern. Same for a very large area of skin. For small-ish areas, there are blotches, medium stripes, and large spots. In fact, the mathematics of this is very similar to the maths behind music. When you hear the note from a drum, it depends upon the size of the drum skin and the area which there is for a wave to form. And it's the same. In fact, now you may be able to tell me why Charlie has stripes on his tail. Because his tail is smaller than the rest of his body, the rest of his body gets spots. This is also the reason why there are no animals which have a stripy body and a spotted tail. Now, why then is the tiger stripy when it's bigger than a cheetah? Well, you have to realize that not all animals get their coat patterns at the same stage of embryo development. The tiger embryo would have been smaller than the cheetah when it got its pattern, so it developed stripes. And then it grew up to be bigger than the cheetah, but it still has stripes. And this is great, I think. So Turing's prediction managed to replicate reality. His theory was, it's what we see in the animal world. And this is really cool. This is what I really like about mathematics. Because this abstract equation that I always forget the name of actually does reflect reality. And this just goes to show that the beauty of mathematics is more than skin deep.
Thank you, Jennifer. It's a fascinating relationship between mathematics and natural phenomena, and Turing was deeply fascinated by this subject. You may be aware that around the time that Alan Turing was studying this phenomenon, another mathematician in America called John von Neumann came up with the idea of cellular automata. Can you tell us a little bit about that and how those automata can replicate nature in terms of mathematics?
No, I'm sorry. I'm actually just really passionate about Alan Turing.
Okay, okay. So you're a Turing
Neumann
girl.
Did a lot of cool stuff, but no, I'm sorry. I don't know about that.
Okay.
No sounds worries. Interesting, though.
Well, Alan Turing, of course, being sort of celebrated, I think was last year, was the... I can't even remember what the occasion was. But anyway, Alan Turing also, you mentioned he was the father of computing. Do you know what his contribution was to computer science?
I mean, in computer science, there is this thing called a Turing machine, which when he came up with this, it was just a completely theoretical idea. And now it is actually the basis of all modern digital computers. It is the model on which our computers work. And he was also really active in code breaking as well.
That's what he's clearly famous for among the wider public, but yes, as the father of computing.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Do you know what biologically actually produces the colours in the coat of the cheetah?
I do not, because neither do the biologists.
at the moment it's kind of unknown, because it's extremely difficult to study. The pattern formation actually happens in a very, very narrow time window, when the embryo is only a few weeks old. So to study this, you would have to get a pregnant
pregnant animal and cut it open. And but yeah, it's not an ethical study, so nobody really knows, okay? But there have been suggestions that Turing's model seems to be correct, that there are two chemicals, an activator and an inhibitor, which activate and inhibit the production of melanin in the skin cells.
Thank you.
So it could be right.
It's not fair for Jennifer to know if the biologists don't know either. Applying the Turing test to wildlife, Jennifer Fowley. So next, playing with home advantage, we have the reigning UK champion, Caroline Shenton-Taylor. Caroline is an industrial physicist doing government research involving superconducting magnets, powerful X-ray sources, and ultra-low temperatures, which makes her sound like one of those shadowy figures from the X-Files, rather than, as she is, someone who takes part in lots of science outreach work with children, helping them build water rockets to try and break world records, teaching them to recognize tree bark when blindfolded, which I suppose could come in handy if you ever need to find a tree and it's a dark night. Now, having introduced her in the UK final and last night's semi-final by saying her name's an anagram of an erotic loony enthralls, I thought I'd better find a new one for the final. So please welcome horny national selector, Caroline Shenton-Taylor.
This evening, I'd like to share with you how a 1950s cup of tea stirred up science. So it started back in the 1940s when a pioneering group of scientists wondered if they could use magnetic fields to look inside materials. Because a material is made up of atoms, and inside each atom there's a nucleus. And the nucleus has got a property called spin, which you can imagine is it rotating on an axis. Now the neat thing is if you put it near a strong magnet, it doesn't only rotate, it also wobbles. Even better, if you hit it with a radio wave, you can make it wobble so much, it flips over. Now those scientists realized that they could detect the wobbles and flips of the nucleus outside the material, and they could use them to work out what the structure was on the inside. They called the technique nuclear magnetic resonance. But there was a problem. You had to put the sample in a strong magnetic field, but more than that, the magnetic field had to be even. Now, in the 1950s, we could make the magnets pretty strong, but we couldn't make them that even. The story goes a young scientist called Felix Bloch was pondering the problem whilst having a cup of tea. And as he stood there stirring his tea, he wondered, could he stir the sample? Now, this is like when you put milk into your tea and you mix it in. Only he was talking about mixing up the atoms inside the magnetic field. Well, they tried it, and they suddenly got a better, crisper picture of inside the structure. And that was the point that other scientists started to get interested. If you look at the history of nuclear magnetic resonance, it's linked to 6 Nobel Prizes. 3 were in physics, 2 were in chemistry, and 1 was in medicine. It really is a technique that has been embraced by the whole scientific community. Physicists, biologists, chemists, we've all worked together using magnetic fields to look inside materials that interest us. Over the last 50 years, we've used magnetic fields to look inside the human body, to look at the soft tissue. But we've also used them to look inside ceramics, to work out why they're so hard. We've used them to look inside rocks, to see if there might be natural gas nearby. And I think, perhaps most excitingly of all, last year a team of scientists used them to look at the HIV virus, to try to work out how and why it becomes infectious. And so I think when Felix Bloch stirred that cup of tea, he did way more than he realized. Not only did he work out that he could stir his sample, but he helped mix up the way scientists work together in the development of the magnetic technique. And so, by embracing it as a scientific community as a whole, and blending our different sets of expertise, that is when I think we can have truly brilliant, magical science. And that is how a 1950s cup of tea helped stir up science.
Well, Caroline, congratulations on explaining NMR in 3 minutes. That was a challenge. You did as well as you could do in 3 minutes. But I'd like to probe you a bit more. You mentioned about the stirring of the cup of tea. What is it about stirring up different kinds of atoms together that makes an image become clearer.
So right at the beginning, it was the fact that the magnetic field
wasn't even across the sample, and so he was getting kind of like hot spots in different places, and then the magnetic field was interacting with the magnetic moment, which is when I did the wobbles and flips bit. If you dig into that a bit deeper, it's actually the kind of the nuclear structure itself and the protons and the quarks that it was interacting with.
And because it wasn't doing it consistently in different places, you were getting kind of a blurred signature, a blurred signal out the other side. The mixing of it actually kind of sharpened up the signal bizarrely because it counteracted those interactions.
But I don't want to step in MRI scanner and have someone start mixing up my insides.
Oh, see, the good thing is we got better. So we can now actually make magnets that are even across the sample. So now you don't have to be mixed up. But intriguingly, if you want to look at solids, it's actually still beneficial sometimes to spin them. Because if you spin them, basically, molecules can be chatty and they like to talk to each other, and the act of spinning them gets rid of those interactions. If you spin them at 54.7 degrees, that's the magic angle, we call it, that you have to spin at.
Thank you.
I want to ask you a question about your research, if it's not secret, I mean. Are there any interesting things happening to magnets at low temperatures? What's going on there?
The introduction was lovely from Quentin. My current field, the last few years, is actually spent working with radiation and radioactivity, so I don't think I'm quite on the cutting edge of the magnetic stuff right at the moment. I think quantum stuff seems to be what's in the headline news at the moment. Mm-hmm. But yeah.
NMR's quantum?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. Science Without a Spin from Caroline Shenton Taylor. And I like the way she said the introduction from Quentin was lovely, meaning the introduction from Quentin was not quite up to date. But that's the trouble of doing shadowy government research where we've got no details. And also, Caroline, if you want a better anagram that you can use, Caroline Shenton Taylor, notionally not research. Now, remember what I said about the semi-finals with 23 people representing 25 countries and how it had been whittled down to 10 people representing 13 countries? Yes? I'm glad, really. That was slightly worrying me there for a second there. So Porik Flood is the reason why. Not only did he win the sole multinational competition, Famelab Benelux, which, as the name implies, spans Belgium, the Netherlands, and Luxembourg, he's also Irish. And since there's nobody else from Ireland in the final, I guess they'll be rooting for him too. So Porik is currently finishing his PhD at Wageningen University in the Netherlands. I do love saying that. Looking at how to use plant genetics and natural variation to make various crops easier to grow and tastier. And when he's not doing this at the lab, he's doing his own private field work as he loves eating wild plants whenever and wherever he can find them. So win or lose, you may find him later snacking in the hedgerows and flower beds of Cheltenham, but not until we Benny luxuriate in 3 minutes of Porik Flood.
Imagine you were inside a leaf. It's a sunny day, and the cells around you are glowing with the soft green light. You move into one of these cells, and you see that this green glow is coming from melon-shaped objects called chloroplasts. As you look closer, you see tiny antennae harvesting this light and channeling it down to a reaction center. It is at this point that light becomes life. This process is known as photosynthesis. Literally building with light. It is the fundament of all life on Earth. The energy I am using to talk to you right now, the air we are breathing, and even the fossil fuels that power our economy all come from photosynthesis. I'm telling you this because our population looks set to reach 9 to 10 billion by 2050. This is a massive increase in the number of people that need to be fed, and it is way beyond our current capacity to produce food. But believe it or not, we have faced such a challenge before. In the 1950s, the world's population reached 2.5 billion. And for many experts, further sustainable growth seemed an impossibility. They predicted massive famines and the collapse of our civilization and referred to it as the population bomb. But thankfully, some scientists did not give up. They had a vision, and collectively they brought about an agricultural transformation like nothing we have ever seen before. They quadrupled yields in a matter of years in what became known as the Green Revolution. The man who spearheaded this was Nobel Prize winner Norman Borlaug, who was credited with saving more lives than any other individual in the history of our species. His work was so incredibly successful that in the developed world we went from potential food shortage to food mountains. But this is no longer the case. The population time bomb has not stopped ticking, and that is where photosynthesis comes in. The scientists of the Green Revolution did an amazing job at increasing crop productivity, but they never managed to improve photosynthesis. In fact, some scientists still say that it can't be done. But already, from my own research, I say otherwise. There is a resource out there, a resource which is the fuel of evolution and which we can tap into. This resource is genetic variation. In the case of photosynthesis, this variation manifests as differences in the efficiency at which plants convert light to life. The genetic basis of these differences can be used to create plants which will feed and fuel our future. We must increase the productivity of our crops so that we can buy the world time to reach a point of population stability. In the words of Norman Borlaug, you can't build a peaceful world on empty stomachs and human misery. We need a second green revolution, and photosynthesis is one key which cannot be left unturned.
Okay. Enough. You mentioned that photosynthesis is a process where genetic modification could help enhance, improve efficiency.
It's not just genetic modification. So I'm talking about natural genetic variation. So in all species, including humans, there is variation. That's why we look different. And you can use this variation to alter traits. You can breed for it. So it's not just GMOs, it's also natural breeding. GMOs is also an avenue, but we should use everything we've got. And I'm looking at natural variation, which is present in species, trying to find what it is, the genetic basis for these differences we see, and then to use this, hopefully, to increase photosynthetic outputs.
Isn't photosynthesis already a very efficient biological process? How can we improve any further on nature?
Yeah, well, I like that question. So lots of people, lots of scientists actually said you can't do this because there's been, 2-3 billion years of evolution optimizing this process. We surely can't improve that. But that's not true, okay? Agricultural systems are very different from natural systems. In natural systems, things compete. So their main goal is to produce offspring. But in agriculture, our main goal is that they produce food. So we can actually make plants more cooperative. Also, they're living in very stressful conditions. So it's kind of like a Ferrari. A Ferrari is going to run very well, but it's not going to do well off-road. So sometimes you need compromise on speed so that you can do well in more rough environments, like a Jeep, for example. It's the same with photosynthesis. Plants that live in the wild, they need to be able to deal with multiple environments. But if we control the environment, like in an agricultural context, we can make them go much faster without the negative side effects they would have in nature.
Have to leave it there for the half Jeep, half Ferrari, Boric mud.
He'll be in the bar later, Alice. You can ask him then. It's all right. Now, we are halfway, and the next finalist has come a long way, the furthest of anyone tonight, and it's our winner from Hong Kong, Dong Ding Li. A master's student of environmental engineering and management in Hong Kong University of Science and Technology, Ding's semi-final talk about why smiling makes you likable proved its own point by making the judges like Ding enough to send her through to tonight's final. But will she be grinning broadly in a few minutes' time? A big smile and a bigger hand, please, for our Hong Kong champion, Ding Li.
We like dancing? Me too. But have you wondered why every time we listen to rhythm, we kind of like moving our body? And it's kind of weird, like it's instinctive to human and it's rarely found in other animals. And more interesting is that it is actually dominated by anticipation, not reaction, like we don't react to the beat, we predict it. And we human use often express our perception of beat with our rhythmic movement. But why do we moved it a bit, According to Dr. A.D. Padesh, this is actually because our brain motor system links to our auditory cortex, which form names, and this underprint our ability to dance. And also, when we listen to rhythm, our cerebellum is stimulated, and this is the region that is involved with timing and coordination of movement. So every time you listen to rhythm, you dance. But why do humans evolve to move to the beat? Why do humans evolve to dance? Now this brings us back to a long time ago when we were all like ho 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 ho. And because this is because the ability to dance is actually linked to the ability to survival. And why I say that? Obviously, dancing gets you laid. Right? And it was Charles Darwin that first proposed that dance help us in selecting our best mate. And good dancing actually displayed our quality in symmetrical, coordinated, and rhythmic. And this is often linked to survival. And when these individuals survive, they reproduce, and we're all offspring of good dancers. Besides, our prehistorical ancestors is actually used dance to communicate and bond with each other. So they would be like, ho, ho, ho. Like, yeah, so early humans who are more coordinated, more rhythmic, actually have better evolutionary advantages. And the ability to synchronize with rhythmic beats is actually a result from a change in break structure driven by evolution. So next time when you get on the dance floor, someone asks you, oh, whoa, where you got that move? Tell them, just by a million years of evolution, baby.
Thank you, thank you. Dingley, that was fantastic. The evolutionary origins of dance, I love it. I'd like to ask a question though. Is there a possibility that this may not be an adaptation? Is there a possibility that this could be an evolutionary spandrel?
But actually, this is not a really adaptation. It's like we select, like natural selection, we select the best dancer in our community, and those are the best one that can reproduce, and we're all like, we're born to be a dancer, like we're born to dance. So it's not really adaptations though, yeah.
But it's an adaptation which has come about through sexual selection, you're arguing. Is there, what I'm asking is that, could there be another reason for it? Could it just be an emergent property because of something else?
Yeah, there is. I'm so glad you asked that. Yeah, because actually a recent study shows that the ability to move to the beat is actually linked to the ability in verbal learning. Parrots and humans who learned verbally, like, verbal learning. They are the only animals that we actually move to the beat. You listen, you hear the rhythm, and then you move it to the beat. And it is suggests that maybe moving to the beat, like how you predict rhythm, help us to learn how to speak, learn language, verbally communicate with each other. And this is also one of the reasons, other than like having sex and dancing with each other. Yeah.
It's fascinating, this relationship between what we consider as beautiful or interesting with what happens in our brain. And I just want to ask you a very quick question. There's a connection between music and rhythm, yeah? Is that also wired in the brain?
Yeah, that is true. Actually, why we love dance so much, other than rhythm, is music. Because music stimulates our brain reward system, and also because the reward system is closely linked to motor region. And that's why when you listen to music, like rhythm / music, and then you'll be like instantly connect to your motor region, which makes you want to dance.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, please clap your hands rhythmically and go all tingly for Dingley. There is a bit of John Travolta in my DNA, I don't know where it's gone. Now, this year, Famelab achieved something that even the likes of Sir Cliff Richard and Kylie, the Kinks and Take That,
have all singularly and albumily failed to do. We cracked America, staging our first full-on Famelab USA competition. Now, we had a preliminary outing there a couple of years back with a NASA-only version, which is impressive enough. NASA, these are the people who put people on the moon. And here were they, adopting and adapting an idea that originated here in Cheltenham. Very exciting. Even more exciting, they got their final hosted by Nichelle Nichols, who was the original Uhura in Star Trek, thus linking Famelab not only with the mighty NASA, but with the even mightier Federation. Now, that was great. That was great. But there are still a few scientists left in America not working directly for NASA, and we wanted them to have a chance at Famelab too. So this year, again, with a lot of help from NASA, we went nationwide, and after something only marginally less protracted than the US election process, Lyle Tomlinson emerged as their winner. A graduate student at Stony Brook University on Long Island, Lyle is investigating how stem cells in our head are affected by exercise. He's also doing the practical side of it as well, because he's a jogger, and he may stretch a few of our brain cells over the next 3 minutes. Hail to the Chief Famelab of USA, Lyle Tomlinson.
So, by show of hands, how many of you have forgotten the names of people you just recently met? Ah, so we have something in common, okay. But if you guys are really anything like me, you've probably also walked into rooms in your house before and said, wait, what was I doing here? Or maybe you've done my favorite and gone on that long search to find your keys in the morning only to realize they're in your pocket. You see, it's senior moments like these that make us question our memories and wonder what we can do to make them better. Well, science may have the answer to some of these memory problems, and it may be just as simple as running more. You see, the surprising thing is, people who run tend to do better on memory tests, like those involving recalling lists of words or recognizing objects. But that seems a little far-fetched, right? I mean, normally people don't associate brain and brawn, so how would an exercise boost in memory even work? Well, some scientists think that it has something to do with a region of your brain that's kind of close to your temples, but a little further in, called the hippocampus, and it's really important for memory. It helps you remember the little things, like where your keys are in the morning, to big, significant personal events, like the birth of a child or even a first kiss. Some scientists think that it's behind this exercise increase in memory because it has stem cells. And these stem cells act like little babies, poised and ready to become neurons dedicated to memory. Their development acts kind of like the RAM you might find in a personal computer or a smartphone. They help us acquire and retrieve new memories more efficiently. And aerobic exercise, in a number of studies, has been shown to increase the number of stem cells found in this area of the brain. And you guys have been paying for computer memory this whole time. You can run and get your own memory for free. But there's still more work to be done. Currently, scientists are trying to put together a more accurate picture of how this might work by using the brains of exercising mice, rats, and even humans. Because even though how this works might not matter for you or I, it may make a big difference for people with memory conditions. So another surprising thing is that aerobic exercise seems to delay the onset of dementia. In a number of studies in mice, aerobic exercise has also been shown to slow the age-related death of stem cells. So if we can figure out what exercise factors are protecting these cells from dying off, we could potentially use them as treatments for people with memory conditions. But the work is still a little far off, and we still have much more work to do. We need to find candidates that can actually do this. But while we're waiting, I'm going to go outside for a run, because it might improve my memory, and it would be much better than being embarrassed asking for people's names. Thank you.
Thank you very much for a fascinating talk. Now, I'm a little puzzled because, say for example, you know, I grow very old and I'm lucky enough to grow old and I start having memory condition. And then I need to exercise in order to do that better. Maybe I'm not able to exercise in my late 70s. What's gonna happen to me?
So you actually may have some other options. So there are actually a number of studies being done in many different kinds of aerobic exercise. So they've done studies with people who not only run, but swim, and even just walk more. They have found that they have not only the decrease or the decreased risk of getting dementia, but also seem to do slightly better on memory tests. Okay. So there are options for you.
George is only in his mid-60s.
Actually in his 70s. Doesn't look it. Doesn't look it.
Lyle, that was brilliant. Thank you very much.
Yeah.
I'd just like to ask you a little bit more about these stem cells and whether there's anything else that we can do to kind of encourage them to engage with other cells in the brain and to help us.
Yeah, so there's actually another phenomenon that scientists usually look at when they're also looking at aerobic exercise. So a lot of times, most of the studies that are done in aerobic exercise, they're done in mice. But there are also tons of aerobic exercise studies done in humans. One thing that doesn't seem to translate, because we're still trying to figure out what it means for us, is this thing called enriched environment. So for mice, it means that you give them tons of toys every day and feed them new foods. You're basically leaving them in a very enriched, very stimulating environment. And that seems to have the same effect on the stem cells that running does. So it increases the number. So what that means for us, people are still trying to figure out, but for what most scientists say about it is just, you know, stay stimulated, keep reading, keep yourself active mentally. So.
Okay, stimulate your applause, please, for our Famelab USA champion. Lyle Tomlinson.
Just a senior moment there.
Next, the story of the translated translator. Our Romanian champion, Bogdan Gheorghiu, fought his life as all sorted. He was happy enough making a decent living, swapping words between different languages for various employers. But then, one night, he looked up and never looked back. He saw Saturn through a telescope and decided there and then to ring some changes and become an astronomer. He's now on his way, studying at the physics faculty at the Alexandra Yoannoukouzi University, or university, it sounds roughly like that, I didn't check the pronunciation, and spending all the time he can staring up at the heavens. He's gone from translator to translunar, but will he leave us entranced tonight? Defying astronomical odds, we bring you Bogdan Gheorghiu.
The Big Bang Theory. What could possibly make a rational astrophysicist believe that all the matter, all the energy, the entire universe was once concentrated in an infinitely dense and small point? That sounds crazy. However, Albert Einstein explained how space is like a 3D fabric that can be stretched and curved. And Edwin Hubble, who was an actual human being before being a telescope, discovered the fact that the universe was expanding. And if today the universe is expanding, then yesterday it was smaller. Turn back the clock long enough and the universe had a beginning. If you take a certain kind of telescope and you point it in any direction in space, you can see the echo of the Big Bang, a background glow, a temperature of 3 Kelvin, which is very cold, but still 3 degrees more than 0 Kelvin. It is a free heat found everywhere in the universe that we called the cosmic microwave background radiation. Now, we have all known ever since we were little children that the speed of light is finite. So, the further back I look in the universe, the deeper in the past I see. And what do I notice? I notice that in the past, the universe was hotter and hotter and hotter. We never see stars older than 13.8 billion years, the age of the universe. Also, according to the Big Bang Theory, a millionth of a millionth, of a millionth of a millionth, of a millionth of a millionth, of a second after the Big Bang, the universe expanded from the size of a subatomic particle to the size of a ping pong ball. That is a huge expansion in a short amount of time. And such a violent event sends shockwaves through the fabric of space-time itself, called gravitational waves. Now, how cool would it be if we actually found those waves? They could tell us about the birth of our universe. But how could we detect them after almost 14 billion years? Imagine an ocean. Imagine the waves coming in one by one and disturbing the grains of sand on the shore. The waves go back into the ocean, but they leave traces in the sand. Now, the universe is not made of sand, but it is full of the cosmic microwave background radiation. And scientists have discovered the traces of the gravitational waves created by the Big Bang on the cosmic microwave background radiation. And they did it this year. If this isn't evidence, I don't know what is. Can you feel it? Can you feel how close we've come to answering this old question, where do we come from? Thank you.
Bobok, then like you, I was very excited by that result earlier this year. Have you heard the most recent news, which may be what they detected, which they thought was ripples, gravitational waves from the Big Bang? It was just dust, space dust.
Yeah, I haven't heard that news, but of course, this is just a first experiment. There has to be more experiments that can confirm that. But it is an extraordinary finding, and maybe it will not be confirmed, but so far it's we got our hopes up.
You mentioned that the waves, the gravitational waves from the Big Bang, leaving an imprint on the cosmic microwave background. Do you know how? I mean, what is it they see when they detect this radiation from space?
Okay, the cosmic microwave background radiation is like a baby picture of the universe. So imagine the universe in a picture, looking all cute and funny and sweet. But the picture is a little bit distorted, and those distortions.
The picture is distorted in such a way that the only culprit for it could be the gravitational waves. But what you asked me is exactly what happened. So it's about the light polarization. Normally, the light is oriented from the hot spots to the cold spots, but with the gravitational waves, that orientation isn't as it normally should be. So that detection, 50% of the cosmic background radiation, that detection made them believe that it was the gravitational waves.
It was unfair to ask you to explain something as technical as that, because I couldn't do it.
Light polarization is very complicated to explain.
I agree, absolutely.
Fair question. 5-yard penalty for Janelle Khalili. Big bang for Bogdan Georgiou. Nearly there, but we've still two more to share. And penultimately, we've Ricardo More, a master's student of molecular biology at Barcelona University and our current Famelab champ for Spain. Now, when Ricardo chose being overweight as the subject for his semi-final, some said fat chance. But the judges plumped for him after he stuffed more fab fat facts into 3 minutes than is strictly healthy. Now, that is partly because, by his own admission, he's obsessed with obesity and other weighty matters. Ricardo says he loves studying fat, he loves eating fat, and that he's come to Cheltenham in search of new sources of fat to sample. But having already chewed the fat in the semis, what's he got left in the larder? Well, Ricardo More wants to say that not only is he a master's student, he's a Jedi master, a Jedi knight, the first to take part in Famelab, and he's still deciding which side of the force he's on. This will possibly make sense after 3 minutes with the Moorish Ricardo More.
How many of you do hate those people who eat and swallow and stay slim? I really hate them, but I'm investigating their secret. It's brown fat. Okay. I will use an Earth language so you can understand. The brown side of the force. Brown fat is fat that burns fat off, a slimming fat, which lies hidden in our body among white fat. That white fat is the bad fat, the fucking fat we all know, whose mission is to store energy as a pantry for worse times. Brown fat does the opposite. It takes the energy stored in white fat, burning it and releasing heat. I call it Charmander fat. Let's think about the moment of our birth. It's the most traumatic moment of our life, even more traumatic than calling your teacher mom. It's even worse with your thesis supervisor. Because once we are out of mom's belly, we must make our own heat. But something extraordinary happens. Our first sip of mom's milk sends a signal that activates brown fat, keeping us warm. Until recently, it was thought that adults lose completely brown fat. but it's still there. It's dormant, infiltrated between white fat, incognito. As a spy, I'm fat. Brown fat. It's really waiting for a signal to activate. And capturing this signal is the goal we pursue. Because if brown fat were chronically activated, it would burn about 400 grams of fat per month, the equivalent to a 40-minute spinning session every 3 days. We know two things that trigger brown fat to long term. One is exposure to cold. That's a free country, you can do it. The other is exercise. No thanks. However, exercise and exposure to cold, so shivering, have both something in common: muscular contraction. So if we catch the signal that muscles send to fat when they contract, and we put it in a pill, we will be very rich, telling the brown fat to reveal its true identity, to activate and join the brown side of the force, burning white fat off. Until that pill, keep cold, and may the brown be with you.
So what's the best way to get rid of the fat, then?
If I could answer this question, I would be really, really rich. But what I suggest to everybody is never trust in those things like books, TV programs, or magazines that say something about losing weight in a short period. This is always a lie. Always. Fast diet or fast losing weight is always rubbish.
Okay.
Do you think it's a good idea from a health point of view to suggest to people that they wouldn't need to exercise and they could just put this secret in a pill?
Okay. Because for this pill, or whatever it will be for obese person. And exercise could be somehow dangerous for obese person. There are people who are really risking their joints if they make exercise, or for elderly people, for example. And in fact, a lot of people ask me, why are you putting a lot of money and a lot of research resources on investigating something that could be solved by exercise and diet? But it's not true. This will work on preventing obesity, but for already obese person, their metabolism is somehow really, really crazy. So their own fat make like resistant stuff to receive the signals that our body sends to the fat to don't catch more energy or don't use their stores.
Okay, one Thank more time you. For the Thank Phantom you. Menace Thank of you. Ricardo Obi-Wan Morey. And Ricardo More is an anagram of courier or mad. And I'm pretty sure he's not a courier. So that just leaves one final finalist. And just like in last night's semi-final, we polished things off with our Polish winner, Joanna Bagniewska. Now, in some ways, Joanna's an old-fashioned girl. She likes ballroom dancing. She likes mink, although I stress not mink to wear to do research on. She's, in her own words, a restless Polish zoologist and now a lecturer in wildlife conservation at Nottingham Trent University. Joanna, though, is not so old-fashioned as to not be on Twitter, and after her success in last night's semi-final, she tweeted simply, "It worked. Final tomorrow." I'm not quite sure what it is, but if you've got it, get ready to flaunt it. Our Polish champion for 2014, Joanna Bagniewska.
Terrorists, drug lords, who can fight them? The humble honeybee, weapon of choice, a phenomenal sense of smell. Bees use that sense of smell to find flowers to feed on, but it can be useful for us too. In fact, bees can be trained to sniff out drugs and explosives. But how do you train a bee? Bees like sugar, and if they sense it, they stick out their tongues. I bet most of you didn't know that bees have tongues, but they do. Now, if you feed the bees sugar and at the same time present them with a scent of explosives, they quickly learn to make a connection between the two. And so if they smell explosives, they stick out their tongues. It takes our bee recruits as little as 6 seconds to make that connection. Okay, so now we have bees that poke their tongues out when they smell illegal substances. But it's not exactly convenient to look out for the tongues of each individual bee. What we do instead is we immobilize our bee in a teeny box with a ray of infrared light underneath its mouth parts. So when the tongue is extended, the beam is broken, and a response is registered electronically, so we can see it on the computer screen. Now imagine an army of 40 or so sniffer bees, some trained for recognizing cocaine, some for heroin, some for Semtex, etc. If we present them with cargo, and the ones trained for Semtex would stick out their tongues, that means that we will have explosives transported in that cargo. Now, because bees are fast learners, and because they're cheap to maintain, we can actually train an entire squadron at the same time. So it doesn't matter if one bee is having a bad day, because there are still others that will produce a reliable result. That would not be possible with sniffer dogs, who are costly, quite slow learners, and actually their sense of smell is a bit weaker than that of the honeybee. Now, if you're concerned about bee welfare, rest assured, we don't want to hurt our bees. The boxes that they sit in are actually mimicking the shape of the honeycomb, and after 2 days military service, our bees return to a civilian hive where they can focus on what they do best, pollinating. And that is super important for our crop production, especially since bee populations have now been declining. So when you next see a bee, remember to show some respect. They're here to serve and to protect.
I'd like to get this clear. I can understand why bees would have a sense of smell to pick out different pollens and flowers, but how was it discovered that, I mean, is it that they have many more receptors than other species? You know, how do we know they can pick out smells like those of drugs or explosives?
Oh, okay. So we can test their sensitivity. So what we do is we present them with a substance that's quite clean, and then we dilute it more and more and more, and we see at which point they stop reacting. And so if you imagine an Olympic-sized swimming pool, and if you take a drop of a substance and you drop it into that Olympic-sized swimming pool, and then you take 25 Olympic-sized swimming pools and you still have that one drop inside, that is the sensitivity that a bee can sense at. With a dog, you'd have to put a whole bottle of that substance in comparison to get a dog to actually detect that sort of quantity. So this is, I hope that answers your question.
Thank you. Yeah.
In terms of sense of smell, then, are bees it? I mean, are there any animals that have a superior sense of smell?
Well, there are others that can be used for detecting explosives that are either carried on people or can be used for landmine detection. So there are tons of animals that do have a very good sense of smell, but for instance, rats have been used in mine detection. So because they're so light, they're lighter than dogs, if they step onto the minefield, they're actually not gonna get the mind to explode. So these have been used in for instance, Tanzania to get rid of the landmines. Mice have been used in Israel to actually detect explosives that could potentially be carried on by people who walk through the airports. There's a different system for detecting that. But a lot of animals can be used in the same way.
Okay, be upstanding, or at least be applauding for Joanna Bagniewska. I'm amazed you got all the way through that and nobody used the phrase sting operation. Joanna Bagniewska, by the way, is an anagram of banjo as awakening, which is a very disturbing notion. Now, and Joanna, in case you've lost count, was our 10th and final finalist, which means judges, it's time to make up your hive mind appropriately after the bees. I do not envy you. This was very, very tough. It is no coincidence that Famelab International is an anagram of fatal to nine lame brain, because their collective decision will be fatal to the hopes of 9 of our 10 finalists. Well, actually, it is a coincidence, and they're not lame brains, and losing isn't fatal. They've all done famelabulously well to get this far, but you get the general idea. So let's hope our judges can do. Cheer them, laugh them, clap them on their way. Maybe it's your last chance to shout out names. We need you to be incisive and decisive. Back here, please, in about 12 minutes. Now, there is no more you can do to influence our judges, but there is something you can do to decide one of our winners. This is where you get out those keypads you should have been given earlier. If anybody hasn't got a keypad, now is the time to start waving frantically, because otherwise you're going to be disenfranchised and disenchanted. If you do start waving frantically, I can't actually see you because there's somebody waving over there, so if somebody can get them a keypad, that would be marvellous. You've got about 3 minutes to do that, because just in case anyone's got so carried away by all the scientific terrificness they've lost track of who was who, here is a quick reminder of all 10 of tonight's finalists.
Italy, and I will talk about a story about an idea in mathematics.
My name's David, I'm representing France in the Famelab International Competition, and tonight I'm going to be talking about sign language and the brain.
My name is Jennifer Fowley, I'm representing Switzerland, and I'm going to talk about something really fascinating, which I hope will get everyone excited about science.
Hi, I'm Caroline Shenton-Taylor. I'm representing the United Kingdom, and tonight I shared how a 1950s cup of tea stirred up science.
Hi, my name is Pori Kulod. I'm representing the Benelux, so Belgium, Netherlands, and Luxembourg. And tonight, I'm going to tell you about where light becomes life and how this is essential for the future survival of our civilization.
I'm Ding Li, I'm from Hong Kong. I'm going to talk about dancing a bit tonight.
My name is Lyle Tomlinson. I'm from the USA. And I'm going to be talking about how exercise affects your memory by stimulating stem cells in your brain.
Hi, my name is Bogdan Gargiu. I'm from Romania. There's an old question that human beings have always asked themselves. Where do we come from? And now, science and technology is very close to giving us the answer.
I'm Ricardo, I'm representing Spain, and I'm going to talk about brown fat, about a way to lose weight without doing anything. About a pill that will change the world and will make someone very, very rich.
Okay. My name is Joanna Bagniewska. I'm representing Poland, and I'll be talking about how bees can detect explosives.
now? Are our judges back? Ooh. Oh, Hank, yes, no, yeah. Oh, they are. They're just shy. That's good to know. That's good to know. So I'm afraid now is the time to start giving prizes and dashing hopes. Judges, let's get you back on stage. Some applause, please, for Jim, George, Alice. Bob and Carol and Ted were unavailable. They look happy. That's good. That's good. You're meant to look stressed. This has been a difficult, draining trip. That's better. That's better. Now, all our winners will get unique Famelab International plaques. Woo. And specially signed science books. Woo. And our champion will also get an iPad. But it's not about the prizes. It's about the glory and the honor. We're going to start with the Alumni Award. And to give it, and also to briefly explain what it is, I'm going to get somebody up here who down the years and across the continents and sometimes the incontinents has given more to this competition than any other. She, in a nice way, is the Minotaur in the middle of the fame labyrinth. Please welcome Director British Council Bulgaria, Lubov Kostova.
Thank you. Thank you, Quentin. But before everything, thank you guys for being so brilliant. Not just the 10 tonight, but every one of you 23 who were here this season. Because this is the beginning. This is the beginning of a huge road for you. You've seen what Famelabbers from last year have done. You've seen what's happening behind that lens over there. I know for a fact that there are people who are missing their own, no, they're celebrating their very own birthday by watching you online. Happy birthday, Stefan. He's a Famelabber as well, because that's what he chose to do. I have to say that this is becoming more and more emotional every year, because what happens is really, from this stage, there's international travel, there are contacts. We very much hope some connections, research connections across borders will be happening. Discoveries that will have started from you meeting here. And without further ado, I want to say that. We have started, this is becoming a tradition. We will have to produce a second plaque because tonight there are two winners of the online vote. Thank you very much, world, for voting. Thank you very much.
Before you say, could you just explain for those who are here, because I haven't said much about how who votes and how and what and why.
Of course. This is a very special vote. In a sense, this is the most important vote for them, because this is from the vote of the international Famelab community out there in the world across five continents, 5,000, 6,000 Famelabbers across the world. Not every one of them is voting, because that would crash the systems. But we have asked every one of the countries to get votes in from each country, and they were allowed, unlike Eurovision, to vote their own country if they felt they were the best candidate. Now, I want to say that this is a really great honor, because I'm going to give away another secret. Your supporters, your greatest fans, your friends who were here behind you and supporting you all along have said that they want to found a new prize for next year, and that would be of the Famelab community within the whole. So this is the biggest prize of all. And I'm going to now announce the two people who have won the hearts, the eyes, the feelings, the invitations across the world from Famelabbers. And those are two women. And let's put it this way. One of them stirs, the other one bees. So can I have Caroline and Joanna here? And because we will have to produce a new plaque, I will split the prize right now this way. Arbitrary, completely arbitrary.
That's one firework for each of you there as well. Oh, congratulations, a cup of tea and the sugar to put in it.
Can I say that over the 8 years of Famelab, there have been over 35 countries taking part at one point or another, and the number is growing. 200 countries in the UN list, we're getting there.
Whoa, thank you. Congratulations, and thanks again to Lubov for everything. You can stay here, stay here! Who knows? There may be more to come. We just can't tell. Now, next, it's the award you all voted on, our audience prize. And I can't speak too highly or sing the praises enough of the person we're going to get up here to give it, because it's me. So, but I do not know the contents of this envelope. The audience prize is not one of the two people up on stage already. And it's not one of our judges either, although Alice Roberts will be giving the prize in a second. The audience prize goes to David Davila. I hope you've got a prize. In a slightly awkward way, we'll hand it for Alice to hand to you.
David. Congratulations.
Thank you so much.
Oh. Still. It's so exciting. Now we've got the judge standing up as well, which is good because we need you in a minute as well. So thank you to everyone who voted, which I hope was everyone. We're not quite done with the audience participation, though. You should have evaluation forms that you would have found on your seats. Don't worry about them now. They're not the usual ones, though, we should say. It's a master's student at the University of the West of England. They're actually doing their thesis on Famelab. And hopefully somebody's also doing a thesis on the effect of over-inhalation of smoke while hosting events. As an extra incentive, all the forms will go into a prize draw. And I'm not quite sure, either one person gets two bottles of wine or two of you get one bottle of wine. But there's alcohol involved at some stage. But you are helping somebody do a master's thesis, so please do fill them in. Right, we've had the verdict of participating Famelab countries. We've had the participating members of the audience. But now, and this is just how modern democracy works, the big decisions are not in the hands of the many, but the few. Our three judges. Alice, perhaps before revealing the identity of our two joint runners-up, a little bit about the difficult, traumatic process you went through to reach this decision, because it was an impossible, implausible, impractical task to try and pick winners from this lot.
It is really difficult. You were all so brilliant. It is amazing to be here tonight and to see this generation of science communicators on a global scale as well. And thank you for coming here tonight to be part of this. And well done, you know, getting this far, as we said right at the very beginning, is an accolade in its own right. We all thought that the presentations tonight were superb for a number of reasons. I thought that it was lovely to see science being talked about as a dynamic process. We got a real sense of the excitement of discovery, the way that ideas change over time. This isn't just a set of facts which they set in stone. That dynamic excitement of science was, to me, something that shone through in everybody's talk. But I know that George and Jim want to say a little as well.
Oh, good. I'd hate them to have non-speaking roles.
Right. Thank you.
George.
Well, I think there's two things about Famelab that always inspire me. And the first two, but big ones. Well, first, the contestants themselves, of course. You know, young minds filled with curiosity about natural phenomena, exploring the world, trying to answer, you know, deep questions like, you know, the connection of mathematics and the spots on a leopard, but also applying their curiosity and their skills into solving real-world problems like, you know, population growth, famine, health, et cetera, et cetera. And I think the second thing that inspires me is you, the audience, that are so many, and you're here tonight to enjoy those contestants. And I think you contestants should offer an applause to the audience for listening to you and enjoying you. Because you deserve that as well. And it's this connection between people in the audience and contestants on stage that I find so fascinating and I find so interesting about Famelab.
Jim.
I've loved this. It's a real privilege to be up here judging. But on the other hand, we're looking at some of these great young scientists who know their stuff. They know their subject very deeply, and yet they have a stage presence. They are performers. You can tell the passion coming through. I mean, that's oldie science communicators. We'll be out of a job soon because, I mean, the
I already am.
You're already, yeah, exactly. I'll buy you a beer later, Quentin. He's still bitter.
Pint of bitter, that'll do.
Pint of bitter, right. But, I mean, it is wonderful. I mean, when Famelab first started a few years ago, you could tell, you know, contestants were nervous. They found it difficult to pick the subjects they want to talk about. Here we are. They've had to change from one topic to a new one, and yet it's just as polished. The knowledge is just as deep. The questions we asked them to probe, if they knew their stuff, they did to great depth, and they did it with such charisma and presence. I think it's a real threat to me and my...
You know. You sound a little nervous there, Jim. It's fine. Relax.
Right, too.
Okay, enough of the wonderfulness. Time, I'm afraid, to move in for the kill.
So we have two runners-up.
Joint runners-up, yeah.
And one winner to announce. So I'll start with the first runner-up.
Well, the joint runners-up, so yeah, yeah. Good. But I mean, you need to make it clear there is no hierarchy, yes.
No, there is no hierarchy. Yeah. So this person, we thought, displayed incredible charisma and massive enthusiasm for their subject, an amazing knowledge of neuroscience, especially when it came to our questions, and they were the only person here tonight to simultaneously deliver their presentation in two languages. It is David Davila. Congratulations.
And a sec, we're going to get some. Somebody's coming up to deliver the prizes in a moment. So the second.
And our second, we thought that their answers added clarity to the talk that they'd given, which was fantastic. That they talked about a really refreshing approach to a problem, which put the power back in the hands of the people suffering from the problem. Fantastic use of humour and massively engaging as well. So our second runner up. Is Lyle Tomlinson. Hey. What's up, Lyle?
So, to present the prizes, it's really a privilege to have with us the head of NASA's astrobiology program, already keenly on the stage, Dr. Mary Wojtek.
So I just wanted to thank everyone for a fantastic few days here. We love, as NASA has come to participate in this science communication event, we're very pleased to be part of the Famelab family, and I'm very delighted to be presenting awards to two people from the United States.
We have noticed. Thank you, Mary, and thank you, NASA, for helping Famelab crack America. Yes, that was looking a little bit suspicious, the two Americans and the American, but nobody was arranged. So that just leaves the small matter of who will be our seventh Famelab international champion. Everyone we've seen tonight and the semis has been Famelab-solutely Famelabulous. All winners, there can only be one overall winner. Judges, give us your verdict.
We thought that this person offered us incredibly elegant explanations of their science. We loved the use of metaphor that they used, especially in their answers. We also thought that they described the impact that scientific research can have on our lives exceptionally well. And they ranged in their talk from talking about subcellular structures to talking about challenges facing us on a global level. This person isn't on the stage yet. This person had the ability to synthesize in a talk about photosynthesis. It's Porrick Flood. Congratulations, Porrick.
Calm. It's quite impressive. You managed to get half of them up on stage as winners. And to present the prize, another great pleasure to have with us, British Council's Director of Science, clutching all the prizes, Claire McNulty.
Thanks, Quentin. I just want to say that I know this is the end of the evening, but I think as we've demonstrated, British Council has seen Famelabbers go on to do amazing things all over the world, from mentoring school students starting science festivals, doing TV shows, and the fantastic Big Fan Theory. So it's the end of the evening, but it's definitely the beginning for all of you and all of the finalists around the world who are watching now. But I just want to say congratulations. You were all fantastic. There's only one winner. Well done.
Just like when City won the Premier League. Whoa.
Well, that is it. Lots of people to thank for making tonight, not just tonight, but all the worldwide events leading up to it possible. Huge waves of gratitude go out to the British Council, to NASA, who have this right up there with sending a man to Mars. We're also immensely, intensely grateful to our many local media partners around the world, to Cheltenham Festivals, to our various country sponsors, university hosts across the planet. I hope you're picking up on my subliminal message that this is a planet-wide competition. To former Famelabber Matthew Tosh of Skyburst for the Vorsprung Dirk Pyrotechnics. To the film team, McPherson Stevens. To Juca and all the Famelab team. To Amy, Penelope, and everybody here at the venue. To all the many volunteers who make it happen. To our three judges for ruining so many people's days. And for all of you in the audience. And of course, finally, to our famelabulous Famelab national champions, and especially to our 2014 international winner, Porik.